I'm going to invite the praise team to come forward. Would you stand this morning as we open with a word of Scripture, a prophecy of the Messiah to come? Hear now the word of the Lord from the book of Zechariah, chapter 9, verse 9. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's open in worship this morning as we sing Hosanna. Now that you're comfortable, why don't we stand and greet each other this morning in the name of the Lord. In a cold and flu-friendly way, touch an elbow, nod, smile. No hugging, no kissing. Keep it safe. Welcome, welcome on this Palm Sunday morning. I told the kids they're encouraged to take their palms home today, but if they would be willing to bring them up for the children's message, because we'll use them during the children's message too. I have just a handful of announcements. Usually we have a few songs between the announcements and the prayers, but we're going to do them both together. So just to get the announcements out of the way first, just read through your bulletin thoroughly. There's lots of big stuff, including the whole schedule for Easter week this week. Monday, Thursday with communion is here at 7 p.m. And then I'm going to say this one a couple times, because there's always a person or two who just makes a mistake. And that's okay. Good Friday. You know what? Repeat after me. Good Friday,
Good Friday.
Is not here.
It's
at the Pleasant Hill.
Methodist Church.
Perfect. And spread the word. If you hear anybody say, hey, are you going to the Good Friday service? Make sure you ask them. You know where it's at, right? Because if you show up at First Reformed, nobody's going to be there. It's a community service. All the churches, all the pastors take part. About 6 miles south of town at the Pleasant Hill Methodist Church. Saturday, we are having the Easter egg, our second annual Easter egg hunt. It'll be on the lawn and indoors here. Last year, we had 500 eggs, and it was over in about 1 minute and 30 seconds. So this year, we've got 1,000 eggs. Here's what I'm asking for. If you're willing to come early, the Easter egg hunt is at 9 on Saturday. If you're willing to maybe come at like 7:30, we'll hide some of them Friday night. We'll probably do the indoor ones Friday night, but Saturday morning, it would be awesome to have a little bit of extra help hiding eggs outdoors. I'm not saying this happened last year, but I'd like to avoid it again this year. It didn't happen last year that somebody ran into my house at like 8:45 and shook people awake and said, please, please, for the love of God, could you come help me hide Easter eggs because I'm way behind schedule. If you're willing to help hide eggs, find me after worship or send me a message this week. And then sunrise service, 8 a.m., breakfast right after that, and then Easter service as regular here next Sunday at 9:30. I know we've got some other people with announcements. I'm going to turn it over to Wayne first, because I think he has a couple.
So we had the bags tournament last week. It was on, had 23 teams, which Gavin Burns and Westman Weingarten were the winners. So Wes goes to Church of Monroe, so Gavin's the only one who goes to Church of Prairie City, so the first one Church won. So. We took out Grace Live in the championship.
I thought it wasn't a competition.
But it wasn't a competition. But the real winner was the backpack program. We had $744 that we was able to give to the backpack program. So that was wonderful. So thank you on that. And then a different subject is a wild game feed is 3 weeks from today. We've got quite a list of stuff that we're going to be serving. So that's going to be at 5 o'clock, 5 o'clock to 6:30 we're serving. So that'd be a great event to invite a friend to. We'll have a good time at that. So everyone's welcome on that. And since I don't want to do this again, I'm going to go ahead and have a prayer request while I've got the microphone. Jeff DeRouge is going in tomorrow for some tests on his lungs. He's having some issues. So if you can remember him in prayers, I appreciate it.
Thank you, Wayne. I think Gavin has another announcement.
All right. I know there's one game left in March Madness, but the tournament is complete because no one picked the winner. We'll start with third place, Justin Neveau with 610 points. Second place is Carter Burns with 620 points. And then first place, Grant Burns with 720 points. He was the only one that selected one of the two final teams, which was UConn, but he had Baylor winning. Last place, always have to mention them, Patty DeVries and Amy Burns tied for last. Thanks for everyone for playing.
And as I understand it, the winner correct me if I'm wrong, has to treat the bottom person or tie for bottom to coffee at Coffee and Carnations uptown. Isn't that right?
Yeah.
I think that's right. So, Grant, there you go. I'm just going to say there may be a formal investigation started this Wednesday at consistory meeting on the fact that the two contests we did this month were both won by the families who organized and put on the contests. Sitting with my partner last week at the bags contest and watching, I'm not going to name names, but one pair of Burns boys practiced before they started, and what, I think 7 out of the first 8 bags they threw sank straight through the hole on their first tries. I don't, Wayne, come on. I think next year the rule is going to be everybody gets one Burns as a partner. Because otherwise there's just a whole string of sad faces walking out that door one by one. Other announcements, check your bulletin for the Good News Club that's in there again this week. It is Breadline again this week at 9:30 at the Family Life Center. What other business do we have this morning? What other announcements before we move on to joys and concerns? Any other? Scott. Looking for some help with Easter morning breakfast prep. Easter morning breakfast prep. Even more important than hiding eggs is Easter morning breakfast prep. Find Adavris.
The Senior High Youth Group is going to watch The Passion of Christ tonight at the Senior High Youth Room. We'll start at 5:30 or 30 minutes after the Iowa game is over, whichever comes first. So I'm not sure how long that will take. So,
Senior High Youth, 5:30 or 30 minutes after the Iowa game finishes. Other business or announcements? We will move on to joys and concerns. Wayne mentioned Jeff. We're going to take a moment. I neglected to do this several weeks ago at the baptisms, but we have several families who have officially joined First Reformed Church, and we'd like to recognize them this morning. The first being the Bryles family, Kurt, Alicia, Jocelyn, and Kinsley. Wave your hands. I'm sure everybody knows who you are, but we'll have you wave your hand. Hey! Kurt loves hugs, so make sure you hug him afterwards. Tell him that you're happy that they're here. And then the Van Zee family, Eric, Val, Hannah, Madeline, Landon, and Jonathan. I think they're all here this morning. You guys want to wave? And I know Eric loves hugs as well, but he's willing to donate all his hugs to Kurt, so hug Kurt twice this morning. And then Larry and Cindy Van Wyk, I think, are right there. Hey, can we get a big round of applause for them as well? And Kurt's telling me all the hugs can be donated straight to Larry, so make sure you're welcome to worship. But we love it. We love it when we have new families join. People, just to pitch again for anybody who's not an official member, we are firm believers that the Holy Spirit resides within everyone in God's kingdom, and we love new members because that means we get new people not to volunteer for things, but new people to provide their wisdom and insight and how the Spirit's working in them. So when we have congregational meetings, when we have big issues to talk about, the more people adding the Holy Spirit into the mix, the better we feel. So make sure you grab the Van Wykes and the Bryles and the Van Zees after church and give them an official welcome. Other prayer updates. We did get an update. Some people have been asking about Kix, which is Mark and Abby Bruxford's nephew. Kix, they're hoping to send home soon, but it's looking like he's going to go home with a ventilator, which is going to definitely complicate things at home for a while. And they're just asking for prayers that his lungs would inflate and do the work on their own so he could be past that ventilator as soon as possible. Other updates I have, Carrie Burns let us know that her dad, Carol, will be discharged, I think, tomorrow from skilled care to long-term care, which isn't the ideal location, but his wife is just down the hall in an apartment, so they'll be fairly close together, and she'll be able to visit him often. And then big prayers again this week as we got an update from the Bryles that the doctors think they may have found something, and they're looking to go back at the end of this week. Is that correct? Hopefully, they're going to call with an appointment and try another embolism, hopefully with it locating where they think the leak might be. So we're going to be praying heavily over Kurt this morning as well, that there maybe is a light at the end of this tunnel. Other joys or concerns or updates that I did not cover yet? Any other prayers you would raise for the congregation? Yes, Brenda.
Blakelyn has a mild NEC intestinal infection. She's been without no food for, she'll be without no food for 7 days. She is on the antibiotics. Tuesday, they're gonna do x-rays to see where we stand. Hopefully, everything is going good and we can start feeding her again. But the best news ever is she can have visitors. Visitors.
Hey, granddaughter Blakelyn. Intestinal. Intestinal infection, we're praying for it, that she can get over that so she can.
And there is no after effects. They said caught it in time.
Okay. No surgeries, no nothing. I think they caught it in time to repair. So we'll be praying for Blakelyn this morning. Not only can she finally see visitors, but she'll hopefully be eating soon. Other joys or concerns or updates you mentioned now?
So Cheryl, she had an appointment this past week, and if anybody has talked to her, she seems like she has a cold, but it's not. In 2020, she found out that one of her vocal cords is paralyzed and the other one's working. And back in 2020, they had to put an injection in that paralyzed one so that the good one could go back over and vibrate against it. Well, they found out that the paralyzed one is still okay, it's still good size, but now the right-hand side, the left-hand side, the right-hand's paralyzed, the left-hand side isn't moving far enough. It's not going over far enough to hit that paralyzed one. So that's why she sounds like she has a cold or she can't talk very loud. So she goes in Wednesday to have a procedure where they'll put some needles into her throat and then they'll inject a substance in that one to get it more straight up and down so it will go over and vibrate. She had that done in 2020 and she was not asleep at that time, but she will be asleep this time. Pray that comes back. So again, if you talk to her, if you don't see her around, it's because she can't talk very loud. So thank you.
We'll let Al do the talking for you for a little while. We'll be praying for your, you said Wednesday you go in? Wednesday. Be praying for Cheryl's vocal cord procedure. Other joys or concerns?
First of all, no wonder you didn't scream this morning when Larry tried to pull out in front of you. Being the Christian that he is. Anyway, several times it's been listed in the bulletin to pray for our friend Steve Van Race. Steve was diagnosed with cancer a few years ago, and it has progressed. He is on a final treatment plan. It's a new therapy. They inject radioactive material into his body to try to attack just the cancer cells and leave the immune cell, or not kill the good cells. Anyway, I talked to Rhonda quite often, and she asked if we could continue to pray for Steve and asked that this radiation therapy would, or this radioactive, I should say, therapy would work, and to continue to pray for her strength and endurance as she is his full-time caregiver. He's still at home. And she's just doing the best she can to keep him comfortable and take care of him. They have lots of support, lots of people praying, but they would appreciate prayers from us too. And they appreciated the card that came from this church to them. So, thank you.
We'll be praying for Steve this week and for a while, it sounds like. other joys or concerns. Well, before we pray, the last thing I would mention is we have Lakeview Camp today. We have representatives here from Lakeview Camp who are going to be sharing an update. Lakeview is one of the ministries that we support as a church, and today giving the message we have Joe Brummel is here this morning to give the message. If you go back into the library, there's this great big board that has all the pastors through the history of First Reformed Church. For those of you that aren't aware, Pastor Joe's picture is on that board. He served here, I think, from 1990 to 2000. Is that right? 10 years, right in there somewhere. But they are here, Diane as well, Andrea's folks, for those who don't know. They have a table set up outside for after worship, but they'll be talking more during the message. If there are no other prayers, since we have several folks here who are specifically asking for prayers, I'm going to ask like maybe Lorena to lean up and put a hand on Kurt's shoulder, and maybe Dobby or Lisa lean up and put a hand on Cheryl's shoulder. Who else do we have here this morning that we mentioned? One of the Burns want to lean up and put a hand on Brenda's shoulder as we pray for Blakeland. And then Wayne, I'm going to put a hand up on Mr. Buckley there as we're praying for Sandra. I didn't update. Sandra had her shoulder surgery this week, laparoscopic, and it went very well. And she's in a sling for comfort, but it went very, very well. And who else do we have here that asked for a prayer? If not, why don't you grab the hands of someone from your own household? If you're sitting alone, grab your other hand. And the hands we hold this morning represent not only those within our pews, but all those watching online, all those who are sick or working or traveling, as we know the Holy Spirit ties us all together. Let's come to God in prayer this morning. Heavenly Father, hear our prayers as we enter this final week before Easter. God, we know your Spirit can open our eyes to let us see what it was like to stand there on the road to Jerusalem as Jesus rode through on the donkey. God, hear our cries, both external and within our hearts, of Hosanna, as we await the coming of our Messiah. Lord, give us strength this week to watch as Jesus makes his final walk towards the cross. Lord, let us watch not only the pain and suffering and death that he will endure on our behalf, but also the glory and the resurrection and the joy of what comes on Sunday morning. Lord, as we think about all of the things in life that tug and pull and distract us away from your word, Lord, especially this week as we lead into Easter, help us focus our hearts extra deeply as we witness the passion and the love of your Son, Jesus Christ, to be the one person willing and perfect enough to offer themselves as a sacrifice on our behalf. God, hear our prayers this week for Kurt. Lord, we know you've heard all of our prayers over the many months for the safe travels, for the care of the doctors and the nurses. Lord, especially this week, we would pray that if they were to try this embolism, Lord, that your hand would guide it to be successful. God, we continue to pray for relief and for healing, for the leak of Kurt's spinal fluid. But at the same time, God, we just continue to pray for strength for the family, patience for all four of them as they walk on this journey with Kurt. God, we know that this entire story is in your hands, and you will be walking with them in these coming weeks, just as you have walked with them for the past several years in their whole lives. So God, just be with the Bryles family this week. Lord, hear our prayers for Cheryl as she goes in for her treatment on her vocal cords this week. Lord, we would pray for healing for her as well. Lord, we would pray that in those moments where her voice is not what she wishes it could be, you would grant her peace and patience and comfort. God, we pray for those doctors, surgeons, nurses, all of those who will be treating her this week. We pray for her as even she will not be awake. You are the God who watches us whether we are awake or asleep, whether it is day or night. You are the God that is ever present within and without us. So, Lord, be with Cheryl and Al this week for her treatment. God, continue to hear our prayers for the babies Tara and Kix and Blakelyn. God, hear our prayers for their continued growth and strength. Lord, we are especially praying for Kix to be able to get off of that vent as soon as possible. But in the meantime, God, we would pray that that transition home with a ventilator would be smooth, that they would be able to, as a family, handle all of the different intricacies of running that equipment and keeping Kix safe. God, we pray for the infection in Blakelyn's intestines to clear up. We pray for the family and friends as they are joyously able to come and visit and celebrate this new baby. God, continue to hear our prayers for Mike as he makes his way towards his surgery in mid-April, Lord, that you would keep him comfortable and patient. Continue to hear our prayers for Jim and Steve, all of those we know and love that are battling cancer, whether it be in the stages of treatment or recovery. Lord, we know how many ups and downs can come on those journeys, so God, we would just pray that you would make your presence evident to them, even in their lowest moments. They would be reminded you are the great one who supports them in this battle. God, continue to hear our prayers for Pat with the healing of her foot, for Esther as she continues to recover, that you would give her comfort for her bruised tailbone. God, continue to hear our prayers for Sandra. Lord, we would pray that she would recover quickly from her shoulder surgery and be as comfortable as possible. Lord, we lift up Carol to you this morning as he makes his move to long-term care. God, we know that this will be a tough transition as so many people go through. Lord, we know that he will be separated from his wife. But God, we are rejoicing they'll still be in the same building and able to see each other often. But God, be with him and grant him strength as he moves to long-term care. Lord, we also lift up Jeff to you and his upcoming tests this week, God, that you would make your healing spirit felt in that room, that in the moments before the tests and in the results afterwards, Lord, that he would hear your voice speaking at the same time, reminding him that he is known and loved and under your care. God, again, we lift up to you Austin and Gavin and all of those who are separated from family and friends as they have answered the call to serve. Lord, we know that they can have journeys that can often be lonely and tiring, exhausting in moments, exhilarating in other moments. And God, we would just pray that you would continue to remind them that they have family and friends and communities back here at home that are holding them up in prayer. God, as we enter this Passion Week, as we get closer to Easter, Lord, we know that the more of our burdens we hand over to you, the more focused we will be on the glory that is to come a week from today. God, if there is anything we have said or done or thought, any sins we have committed, any baggage that we carry, things that have been done to us that are out of our control, Lord, if there are things that weigh us down, let us hear your Son's voice as he calls us to bring those burdens to him. that he can shoulder them for us. Lord, we take a moment of silence now to offer to you anything that we need to relieve from ourselves this week. God, as we close this prayer, we remember, as we do so many Sundays, that you have promised to remove our sin as far as the east is from the west. And Lord, as we look towards this week, look towards the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus Christ, look toward the glory and the resurrection and the empty tomb, we remember this morning exactly what it cost to remove that sin from our hearts. So let us close this prayer with the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Children are invited forward this morning for the children's message. Come on down with your change or dollars. If you've got any money for them, wave it in the aisles and they'll come and grab it. Go look for anybody waving a hand and see if they've got any money for you. Oh, you got your palms. Perfect. Oh, thank you. Thank you. Any hands waving out there? Any hands waving out there? Any hands? Oh, there's some hands. Look around, look around. Oh, there's somebody way in the back on the left. Oh, he's all right, he's all right. There's another hand back there on the left. Okay, we got him. There's any hands on the right? Any hands in the middle? Drop your change, drop your money. Oh, there you go. All right, grab a seat if there's no other hands. I can't see if there's any more hands. Oh, we're going to look. We're going to talk about it in just a second. Grab a seat, grab a seat. Grab a seat. I can't see if there's any more hands. Grab a seat, grab a seat. Oh, here we go. We got some more. Oh, we got some more. Oh, boy. All right. Well, here's the first thing I'm going to say. We got a lot of folks up here today. So Andrea is going to be ready, willing, and able to make some extra copies if we need them. And also maybe grab some extra treats if we need them. But she's going to be ready to help in case, just in case. We are looking for the giant egg this morning. Last week, what was in the giant egg?
Crosses.
Crosses. Wooden crosses. I've heard there's something brand new in the giant egg this week. I don't know. But here's what I'm going to say. Here's your clue. It's not behind me. It's somewhere out there. Ready, set, go. Wait a minute, Mac, did you hide it last week?
Yeah.
You know what? That's my fault. That is my fault. I usually say if you hit it, you can't find it. I didn't say that this week. There you go. Well, we might find somebody else. All right, grab a seat. Grab a seat. We'll open it up, but I want everybody to be able to see what's in it. All right. We're going to take a peek at what's inside. And I think we have enough, but if not, Miss Andrea will find the box in my office. You think it's crosses. What else do we think's in there?
A Bible.
Candy.
Very small Bible.
Shake it. Oh, okay. Here we go.
Chocolate.
We got everybody's thinking candy.
Chocolate bunny.
Chocolate bunny. Do you think all of you could split one chocolate bunny?
Yeah.
All right. Whatever it is, we'll hand it out when we're done with children's message, okay, after we pray? All right, let's take a peek. I don't want it to spill out. What's in there?
Fruit snacks.
Look. All right, everybody look over this way. We've got our friend Karen. Wave your hand, Karen. Karen brought us fruit snacks to fill the giant egg with. On the count of three, everybody say thank you, Karen. One, two, three.
Thank you, Karen.
Somebody else this week brought something to put in it for next week, too, but we'll have to see what's inside. All right, all right. Hands to ourselves. Hands to ourselves. Back up. Here's our question. If you brought your palm up, raise it in the air and wave it. Now, in the story we're going to hear in the Bible today, Jesus came riding into town on a donkey, and everybody was waving their palms. Wave them again. And they were all shouting one word. Does anybody know what word they were shouting? Hosanna. So we're going to practice on the count of three. You're going to wave your eggs and shout Hosanna. You ready? Wave your eggs. Wave your palms. I'm all messed up on the eggs this morning. So many scandals at First Reformed. All right, here we go. What are you going to shout on the count of three? One, two, three. I don't know if that was good enough. I think we better get these guys to help. What do you think? Everybody turn and look out there. Here, let's put all the money away. On the count of three, the whole congregation is going to shout it together. One, two, three. Pretty good. Pretty good. All right, here's your question. Before we pray, who can tell me what the word Hosanna means? What? It's a book in the Bible, someone thinks. You think it means pine trees or palm trees?
It means Halloween.
Halloween.
It means that Jesus died on the cross and then he came back alive.
It means Jesus died on the cross and he came back alive. You're closer. What else do we think? Any other guesses for what the word Hosanna means? Anybody out there know what the word Hosanna means?
Nelson.
What?
Nelson.
No, you're close but not close. Anybody out there know what it means? Oh, we do this every year for the children's messages. Does anybody not remember and just doesn't want to say it?
I don't know.
It means, repeat after me, we pray.
Save us.
They were yelling at Jesus, we pray.
Save us.
Why do you think they were yelling, we pray, save us, when he came to town? Oh, my goodness gracious. 10 bonus Bible points because they had sinned and Jesus said, God loves you all and wants you all to still be able to come home and see him. That is why they were yelling Hosanna. So today when you take your palm branches home, you're going to remember that you can pick them up and shake them all week as we're getting closer to Easter. We're going
to
pray.
Close to
Easter? We're 1 week away from Easter. Oh, three Easter egg hunts. Yes, that's something else important. Next Saturday, we're having a big Easter egg hunt here with 1,000 eggs.
A thousand.
Oh, thank you for the shade. All right, I think we better pray before we completely lose control. Well, all right, how do we pray? Can we fold our hands? Can we fold our hands? Bow our heads? Close our eyes? We're going to pray, then we'll hand out snacks and color, and then Andrea will hand out sheets and colors, and you can go back to your parents. And I'm just going to remind everybody, Lorena, did we have a nursery backup today? Yes. Whoever the nursery backup is, you might want to double check. This could be a nursery backup day. Let's pray. Dear God, we are remembering all those people this morning who yelled Hosanna. We pray you save us. God, we remember them because for so long people were told that God was mad at them. God might not love them. They might not be good enough for God. But God, we are remembering this morning that your son Jesus came to remind us that he loves us all. Remind us of that all the way this week to Easter. We pray in your name. And all of God's children said,
Amen.
Amen. All right, I'll invite the praise team to come up. We'll head to this front pew. Hand out our treats. Andrea's got sheets and colors. I'll hand out gummies. And let's stand as we continue in worship this morning. Would you stand as we continue to sing together? introduce our special speaker this morning. Many of you know father-in-law Joe Brummel, past pastor here at First Reformed Church, probably one of the top three reasons I'm standing where I am today, working in ministry because of what he did for me when I was in high school in youth group and took a ne'er-do-well off the street and showed me love. And I don't know what he's doing right now, but if you thought the children's message was a little crazy, it might get even crazier. I don't know, it might be calmer. I don't know. But good to have you here this morning. And when you're finished, we're going to pray for you guys for the camp. Is that all right?
Awesome.
Awesome. All right. Welcome, Joe, this morning.
Am I on? Good morning. This is the day that the Lord has made. That's right out of Scripture. Well, let's try it one more time. This is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad.
Now, what I want you to do is turn and look at least three or four people and give them your best rejoicing look. That's not rejoicing. This is Camp Sunday, and we're going to celebrate. We're going to celebrate Palm Sunday and try to tie that a little bit into camp. And probably most, it's not a message about camp. It's a message about being a parent and how tough that is, being a parent in this day and age. Anybody want to say amen? I'm getting a ringing. Do you need this closer or further? All right. So, scripture this morning. I'm glad the burns are still being brought up. I've got to tell this story. I was officiating a men's league basketball game. Some of you were here. I was officiating it. There were a few burns in the game. Elbows were flying. You think the March Madness is something? I was experiencing Wayne Madness. I was running down the court and I just called a timeout. And Wayne said, who called a timeout? I didn't see anyone call a timeout. I said, I called a timeout. He says, an official can't call a timeout. And I said, I'm having a timeout and getting a drink. Everyone is cooling off. If not, you're getting a tea. And Wayne said, I need a drink too. Psalm 119:94, save me, for I am yours. I have sought out your precepts. Was interesting in researching the whole idea of Hosanna. It's not used very often in Scripture. You know, we think that it was a word that was thrown around a lot. It really wasn't. Just a few times in the Old Testament, Jason just covered it. Hosanna means, aren't you glad you brought that up? Basically, it's like, hey, stop, save us. That's Hosanna. It's like, save us with like 7 exclamation points. It's like somebody throwing fireworks. And they're throwing them in the direction of you. You would yell,
Hosanna.
Yeah, hey, stop. That's what the people are doing. For the longest time in researching, I was just thought it was kind of like, praise you, Jesus. It's so much more than that. It's like, yo, stop! Save us! We are in so much trouble. Psalm 119, Psalm 118. Just a few times in the Old Testament. And very seldom in the New Testament. Save us, God. Save us, Jesus. Let's read the Palm Sunday account from Matthew. Do they read it together or? It's long? Okay. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethpage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. "Say to the daughter Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. And a very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest heaven!" And when Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." The word of the Lord. Let's pray together. God, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for your word, that we can apply it to our lives. God, that your word should come with a warning, because it is sharp, sharper than any two-edged sword. And your goal this morning, oh God, is to cut through all the stuff of our life so that your word could be planted deep in our hearts. So God, may your word have a powerful effect in our hearts, that when we leave here, we are different people than when we came. God, we praise you. And we thank you for this time together. We pray it in your holy name. And God's people said, amen. My wife and I will be at a table in the back handing out camp flyers. Stop and visit with us and just say hi. There's candy back there just for you. So stop back there and chat with us when worship is done. This is the registration. So if your kid has one of these when they come home, that means they're excited about camp. Amen? So kids, stop and grab one of these as well. This is our camp promo. We'll watch it, and then we'll get back to the word.
No, no, stop!
Oh, your love is my delight. Oh, your grace is running wild. Oh, your mercy gives me life. You're the fire in my soul. I've been rescued by your love. I've been purchased with your blood. I've been set free. I'm alive. You're the fire in my soul. Yes, you're the fire in my soul.
I absolutely love Palm Sunday. I absolutely love Palm Sunday because of the kids. I talked to some college students and I said, "Are you doing, when you go home this weekend, are you going to do the kids come in with the palm branches?" And one of the college guys goes, what are you talking about? And I'm like, do you celebrate Palm Sunday at all in your church? And he said, I don't think so. I was like, oh man, it is one of my favorites, the kids. The kids. W.C. Fields, I had to look it up. I wasn't sure who came up with the phrase. W.C. Fields, all you older people that know who that is, raise your hand. He was kind of a role model for our generation. A virtuous life. W.C. Fields said, don't ever share the stage with, go ahead and finish it, children or animals. They'll always upstage you. There were actors, honestly actors, who were like, I will not go on stage with a kid or an animal because all the focus will be on the kid, the animal. Absolutely love kids. During the whole worship, all the joys and concerns, I was just in back holding kids. I was in heaven back there just rocking. I almost had him asleep. A Burns kid. After 10 minutes, I said, whose kid is this? I had absolutely no idea. Kids. Don't ever share the stage with a kid. We tune in online about every other week. We probably watch the worship here. One of the toughest things is when you have about 30 kids up here for the kids' message. Amen? Does anybody here feel sorry for Jason when he's up here? I didn't know which way to go with a Palm Sunday thing. I had to look it up. 583 years before Jesus rode into town on a donkey, it was prophesied that he was going to do that. The word of God is always true. Say amen. 583 years before, the word of God says Jesus will come riding in. I didn't know which way to go with this passage. I also find it really interesting that Jesus said, go and grab the donkey, and if anybody says, hey, what are you doing? Just say, go ahead. The Lord. The Lord. It's getting really close to his death. Usually it's rabbi, master. Jesus doesn't refer to himself very often as the Lord, but it's getting closer to the time that he is going to give his life away. And he actually says, you tell the guy when he goes, hey, what are you doing? Tell him, the Lord. He's claiming his divinity. There are some people in your life, when you witness to them, they'll say, I don't know if Jesus ever really claimed to be the Son of God. Go immediately to this passage. Jesus says, you tell him, the Lord has need of this donkey. I really didn't know which way to go with this passage. I debated it for like 5 days. You ever do that? Well, you don't even start on things until Saturday, so. Oh, I wasn't supposed to say that, was I? Shoot. I finally, as I studied the passage and looked at the passage, I finally got to the question, how'd the kids get there? Where did the kids come from that were waving the palm branches? Now, this is not a seminary kind of question. Don't be going, well, you should know this. You went to school for all that stuff. This is a common sense kind of question. Where did the kids come from? Say that again. The parents. The parents brought them. The parents said, I think this Jesus is a big deal. Let's go check it out. The parents said, where Jesus is, that's where I want to be. Let's go. The kids were not there by accident. Say amen. Parents said, we are going to go see this one who claims to be life. We're going to go see the one who claims to be the Father and I are one. We're going to go see the one, as you mentioned, who raised Lazarus from the dead. We're going to go see this Jesus because he's a big deal. Again, this is not a seminary thing, true or false. All the kids in Jerusalem were there. I'll try somebody else. You were so close. All the kids were there. Probably not. There wouldn't have been room. Why were the kids there? Were they all there? Because the parents had decided, I got to thinking, where else would they have been? I'm guessing that some of them went to some Roman chariot races. You ever been to a Roman? Psst, keep looking at me. You ever been to the Roman chariot races? No. But don't ask her. Seriously, the best part of the Roman chariot race is when they crash, yes. Some were probably there. I've heard that the Roman chariot races were incredible. All the kids weren't there. Because in the Sea of Galilee, I'm guessing that some of them were probably over at the... What happens in the Sea of Galilee? The bass tournament. And I'm sure that some of them were over there at the bass tournament. And as a kid, you got to know this. You don't even have to catch the biggest. You'll get a trophy if you just catch a fish. Yeah, if you weren't at the chariot races, if you weren't at the bass tournament, I'm thinking if Lazarus isn't there, because I don't know, after you get raised from the dead, I don't know how quick you're out in public, but I'm guessing some families, don't you want his autograph? Don't you want Lazarus's autograph? Don't you say to, hey, mom, let's go find Lazarus and get his autograph. He was dead and now he's alive. Let's go find him. When I thought about the passage and how to approach it, the kids just kept coming back to my mind. And it hits me that if Jesus is a big deal for dad, Jesus is going to be a big deal for the kid. If Jesus is a big deal for mom, Jesus is going to be a big deal for, say it. It's not an accident that the kids are there. The parents have said, we're going because Jesus is there. I've been doing this for a long, long time. Say amen. RD said to me when I met him out there, RDs looked at me and said, "We're getting old." And I said, "RD, it's good to see you too." He hasn't changed. He started talking about some cow that about took him out. I am so disappointed in RD. See, in the first couple months I was here, we had a huge snowstorm. And he called the office and he said, "Brummel!" I said, "Who's this?" "Brummel!" "Oh, yes, it's RD. Just wave at everybody. There you go." He loves hugs too, so he said, "What are you doing?" And I'm like, "I'm at my office." He says, "We're running coyotes this morning." I'm like, "What does that got to do with me?" About 15 minutes later, I knew what it had to do with me. About a mile south of town, we were chasing coyotes. He hands me a shotgun. He says, "Do you know what to do with this?" What was funny is, I didn't. And we chased coyotes. I've been doing this for a little while. I was talking to one of the Mrs. Burnses out there, the kid I was holding. I should have got her name, shouldn't I? And we figured out that, oh, there they are. I figured out you might have been one of the first baptisms that I had here. I have been doing this for a little while, and I have found one thing, and it is absolutely gospel truth, that when dad and mom are excited about Jesus, so will the little ones. Say amen. When Jesus became a big deal in your life, it became a big deal in their life. And I said, "I am not going to preach about camp. Although camp is not a bad place to be for a kid. What I did was come to talk about the responsibility of being a parent. I had to look it up online. I wasn't even sure what the stats were anymore. If dad does not go to church and the kid is raised in the church and dad does not go to church, Jesus is not a big deal. 84% of the kids that are raised in church, when dad doesn't come because dad has other things to do, Jesus is not a big deal. Guess what happens to 84% of those kids? Go ahead and tell your neighbor. They don't want to come. I look at these kids and they're waving their palm branches. Dad and mom are doing the same thing. Amen? Dad and mom, they're watching you all the time. They are watching you all the time. Take it from us old timers. And they know what's important to you. They know when it's a big deal to you or not. And I know kids today. They'll have 100 different options this summer. Signed you up for volleyball stuff. Signed you up for dance stuff. Signed you up for driver's ed stuff. Signed you up. Has it changed any? And when you sign them up, for football camp, you're sending the message, this is a big deal. And when you sign them up for cheerleading, for dance, you're saying to them, I agree, this is a big deal. And when you send a message that Jesus is a big deal, they receive that as well. They receive that as well. I love the conversations you have at Walmart. How many go to Walmart in here? I should send this into Walmart. Would they reimburse me for like having like a minute? We should try it. We'll give it all to the deacons here. So, the people you run into at Walmart, does that sometimes surprise you? Like you're walking across the parking lot and I was like, Pastor Joe! He's like, hello. Like, who is it? My brother John lives back in the area now and he looks a lot like me. My brother John has said, I am so tired of going to Walmart. He says, and Hy-Vee's worse. So I'm just walking. All I want is some bread and lunch meat. And somebody goes, Pastor Joe, could you pray for me? He says, the other day I just saved the time. I prayed for the lady. I didn't even say, I'm John, I'm not Joe. We were playing cards recently, and he said, you better watch it, because we were beating him at pitch really bad. He said, you better watch it, and I said, what are you going to do? He says, I'm going to go to Hy-Vee and Pella. I am going to load the shopping cart up with alcohol. Every bit of alcohol I can, and I'm just going to walk around and go, hi, I'm Pastor Joe. I've watched all of my brothers, and I've watched other families, and all I want to do to you as a young parent is I want to say to you, when Jesus is a big deal to you, and they see you doing defos in the morning, and you sign them up for vacation Bible school, and they hear you say things like, I'm going to men's Bible study. It's going to surprise you, but sometimes pastors on a Sunday morning, can I tell them? Sometimes we even feel like staying home because we're tired. But we know and we believe in the bottom of our hearts. Kids are watching. The kids are watching. At Walmart, you didn't think I'd get back to that story, did you? At Walmart, I saw this kid and he waved and I'm like, I kind of know this kid, kind of, but it's like he's all grown up like. He's like, hey, Joe, Joe B. A lot of times they'll call me Joe B at camp. And I'm like, yo, hey, how are you? And he goes, remember me? And when you get to my age, you just go, sure. And then later on, you turn to your wife and go, who was that? You remember me? And I'm like, I remind me. And he goes, I came to camp for like 3 years. And I'm like, yeah. I said, when did you stop? And he goes, seventh grade. And I'm like, how come you're not coming anymore? I said, really, it's cool in high school camp. I said, how come you're not coming to camp? And he goes, and you know what he said? Mom didn't sign me up. And at first I thought maybe he was just you know, jacking around with me or something. And I was waiting for the smile or the laugh. And he looked at me and he was completely serious. The reason I'm not going is because Mom didn't sign me up. So before I'm done, all I want to say to you, if your parents, and you got them like down here, my prayer is that your witness to them is that Jesus is a big deal. And that doesn't stop when they're in fifth grade. And it doesn't stop when they're in seventh grade. And it doesn't stop when they're in tenth grade. That Jesus is just a big deal. Amen? Amen. W.C. Field said, "Don't ever share the stage with kids or animals," and Jesus did both. And you know what is amazing? For 2,000 years, the spotlight has remained on Jesus Christ. Amen? Because Palm Sunday is all about Him. People yelling, families yelling, "Jesus, you got to come and save us." Because the chariot race isn't cutting it. Neither is the bass tournament. And neither is every autograph I've ever received. Jesus, stop and come and save my family. That's my prayer for each and every one of you. That's my prayer for each and every one of you, that you will live out in your family. If you're a grandparent, a parent, uncles, aunts, neighbors, that your witness each and every day is the same witness that happened on the first Palm Sunday. Jesus is the biggest deal that I can find. That's my prayer for each and every one of you. If camp is a part of that, praise God. If not, get them signed up for something else. Where Jesus is a big deal. Let's pray. Thank you, Jesus, for this time of worship, and thank you for so many attentive ears, and thank you for this opportunity to be about Lakeview Camp this morning. The hundreds of kids that will come. I pray, Jesus, that already that you will capture their hearts and they will begin imagining what it would be like to live for you each and every day. For all of the kids up front, all of the kids in this church, the whole congregation says, thank you, Jesus. Bless our day today. Bless our family times together. We pray it in your holy and precious name. And God's people said, amen.
Would you rise this morning as we hear our benediction, say a final prayer over Lakeview Camp, and then we'll close in song together. Let's start with a prayer for Lakeview Camp. When does your first camp kick off, Diana? First week of June, so they've got a few weeks here leading up and lots of details to button down and people to hire and all that stuff. Let's just raise up a prayer for Lakeview Camp this morning before we sing our last song together. God, hear our prayers for Lakeview, for all the adults, all the counselors, all the leaders, all of those folks who will be giving of their time and energy. God, we know that they come in like a storm, just filled up and ready to go with your Spirit. God, we know that as the summer goes on, they begin to tire, get exhausted, but yet your spirit fills them up in the places that they need. So God, we're going to pray for all of those leaders, counselors, cooks, cleaners, everybody, drivers that participate in giving these kids a week at camp. God, we also lift up to you all the children who will be going of any age, whether they are south of Pella or at one of the other camps around Iowa. God, we would just lift up all of the kids who will deepen their relationship with Jesus Christ this summer, whether it be at a camp or a retreat, whether it be with a new friend they make or a counselor in a late night Bible study or prayer. Lord, hear our prayers as a congregation and all the congregations who support Lakeview. God, that your kingdom would continue to be revealed. We pray this in your name. Amen. As you leave this house of worship today, I would invite you to remember that in your lowest moments, in those moments when you feel all might be lost, we serve a God who always answers to the call, Hosanna. Pray, save us. Let's raise our voices one more time as we close in worship. Amen.